Tanto Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lane, A Case for Willows and Lane, by Peter Grainger, narrated by Henrietta Meire. Chapter 1. Emily Willows watched her new neighbour and wondered again. Not that the woman was really a new neighbour any longer. She, this woman, had bought the adjacent house last May, and it was now August. During that time they had barely spoken, and what had been said was no more than the most superficial of politeness. A few good mornings, when they met each other on the path into the bustling little town which some insisted was still a village. Once, about a month ago, when fate had thrown them together in a queue at the butcher's, Emily had made an effort to chat because it really was a little embarrassing by now, being neighbours and not speaking. Her efforts in Mr. Donovan's shop had met with little success. "So," she had said with a smile, approaching the matter as if they were in the habit of acknowledging each other's existence. "How are you finding Polcombe?" There had been a pause, as if the woman, whose name was Lane, that much had been established from a fortuitously misdelivered letter, as if she suspected that it was a trick question. And then came, "Oh, it's absolutely charming." That was all. Charming. As far as Emily Willows was concerned, this was akin to saying that the sea this morning is absolutely a sort of greenish-blue or bluish-green, a statement of the blindingly obvious. Every article and advertisement ever written that has anything to do with Polcombe includes the word charming. It's beyond a cliché, she thought afterwards. It's almost insulting to say that and nothing more. She hadn't given up, though, in the butcher's. "I imagine that it's very different to where you've come from," with a distinctly encouraging smile. "Yes, very." The queue shuffled forward. Mr. Donovan's daughter, Amy, was missing that morning, probably attending an antenatal class, expecting her second, still not married. "Where was that? I hope you don't mind me asking," with a smile so encouraging now that it was beginning to hurt. And the extraordinary thing was that the woman did mind. It was obvious from her frown and pursed lips. "Of course not. I moved down from London." London, home to about 8 million people, and covering tens of thousands of acres. Lord knows how many boroughs and postal districts and suburbs, all with names. But Miss Lane, no sign of a ring, but who knows, was content to say that that's where she had moved from, London. There had been one more attempt to establish a line of communication. "Oh, what a change for you. Was it your work that brought you this way?" Emily doubted that. There had been no suggestion of regular comings and goings, and no sign in her occasional glimpses of business clothes or a briefcase. "No, I'm retired." Emily knew that she had probably failed to hide her surprise at that. Retired. The woman was in her 30s. She was slender to the point of being a little thin, but toned, and when she wore a T-shirt one could see muscles in the arms. How could she possibly be retired? Emily would have said, "Really? What did you used to do?" But Mr. Donovan interrupted with, "Now then, Mrs. Willows, it's Friday, so it must be chops." That's what it means, to be part of a community, to be known. And she hoped that Miss Lane, if Miss she was, might appreciate that and treat her with a little more respect, if she couldn't manage friendship. But when she turned around after being served that morning, she found to her surprise that her next-door neighbour had disappeared. This being a Friday too, all that must have happened 3 weeks ago to the day. Since then, nothing more than a nod when Miss Lane looked in as she passed the house and saw her neighbour looking out at her. There was something quick in the woman's movements that would have caught even the most practiced of curtain twitchers, Emily had reflected uncomfortably, as she watched the figure walking down into the town once more. Now, early on this brilliant August morning, the latest in a long succession of them, she could see the woman at her own front gate, stretching herself very thoroughly before going for a jog, though Emily fancied from what she had seen of this before that a run was a more appropriate term. A black singlet that she could get away with because of her tiny bust, dark blue tracksuit bottoms, and professional-looking white trainers that were most certainly not from the discount store at Trago Mills. She pays a lot of attention to her legs, the hamstrings and things, But it wasn't Emily Willow's imagination. Miss Lane always spends more time working on her left leg than her right. And that makes sense, she thought, nodding to herself, because I have seen her limp once or twice. Nothing very noticeable, and not all the time, but she does for a few steps now and then. And just before she runs, she springs up like that on the balls of her feet, bounces a few times, opens the gate and turns left onto the footpath that takes one up along the steep slope that forms the eastern side of the tiny harbour. Steep it might be, but she never walks that first section. The woman runs up it, leaning into the hill, hunching her shoulders, and punching those muscly arms as if she enjoys the pain, or as if she has in front of her some invisible adversary. Emily Willows looked down at her own steadily spreading middle, and wondered how far she would get up the hill if she tried to run. She had been fit as a girl, and enjoyed school games, but even then she was more of a thrower than a runner. Miss Lane had a good 20 years on her too, and that makes a big difference, doesn't it? Nevertheless, she ought to do something, with her blood pressure seeming to inch up a little each time Dr. Scott managed to detain her in the surgery long enough to measure it. Get one of those DVDs and do a Zumba or something, or start going for proper long walks, instead of her customary 10 minutes up to the top of the rise and a sit on the seat that overlooks the beetling cliffs and the beautifully crinkled blue-green sea beyond. Robert was coming soon, and so there was a point to the morning, which made a nice change. He was bringing a card for her birthday tomorrow because he was on duty all day then, and in the middle of a big case that had had his attention for months, it seemed. As she tidied the kitchen and prepared the coffee machine, she found her thoughts wandering back once more to her neighbour. How far does she run? Sometimes she's gone for an hour or more. Fit people can probably run at 8 or 10 miles an hour if a steady walking pace is 3. Does she really run that far back towards Plymouth? No wonder there isn't an ounce of fat on her. And then Emily Willows had one of those moments that her husband Ron, when he was alive, used to marvel at. He'd say, "Think yourself lucky you weren't born 300 years ago, because they'd have drowned you as a witch." She thought to herself, "I wonder what she's running away from." When the whole of the house had been tidied and all of the downstairs had been hoovered, there was still no sign of her son, and so she went out into the garden. These houses were built in the days when land was cheaper, even in the steep and hidden coves of Cornwall, and her garden was a generous one, and private too. It was overlooked only at the far end by the upstairs of Miss Lane's property, which was further up the hill. Their gardens were separated first by a high, traditional wall of local stone, and then by a substantial wooden fence, now much overgrown with climbing roses, clematis, and jasmine. But where the stone met the wood, there had once been a gate. To be more precise, there still was a gate, but it had not been opened in many a year. Previously, Ling Cottage had belonged to a standoffish couple who had used it only a few weeks each summer, a glorified holiday home, and Emily had never got to know them either. Any opening of the gate, for the bolt was on her own side, would certainly have been viewed as an intrusion. She stood by it now, and realized that even if the rusted bolt gave way, a particularly vigorous, rambling red rose had effectively sealed up the entrance and any prospect of warmer relations with her neighbour. She crossed the lawn that sloped up towards the end of her garden and looked back at the roof and upper windows of next door, still annoyed that she had not bought it in May when she had the chance. It would have suited her, being a little smaller with just 2 bedrooms, and the views of the bay were better. She had mentioned it to Robert, but he had said, "It's a dear old business, Mum. Thousands of pounds just to move next door. And you'd have to sell your own place first. Better off where you are." She had not exactly done what he had told her to do, but his words had produced enough hesitation to allow the place to slip away. A sold sign went up within a matter of days. And she would not have needed to sell her own place. Nowhere near it. She could have bought next door outright, moved in and kept this place as a rental property, producing a much better return than she was currently getting at the bank, even on the 5-year bonds. Robert had no idea how much money his father had left her. She was saving that for a surprise, though she was unlikely to see the look of astonishment on his face when the solicitor told him. Better see the financial advisor too, and review the inheritance tax situation after the budget. Ronald Willows had risen near to the top of the banking profession, and had taken the share options at every opportunity. She smiled at the memory of him, and at the thought of the carefully organized files and folders in his study that detailed the fine estate he had left to her. Yes, if Ron had still been here, she would have persuaded him easily enough, and be living in the house that looked down a little on her own. She had even, she recalled a little guiltily, then gone into the town and visited the estate agents, Andrew Arthur and Spargo, to inquire whether it was too late to put in an offer. She knew Tom Spargo's wife from the WI, and so it didn't seem too impudent a thing to do, in the circumstances. But no, she had been told, a cash buyer, all done and dusted. Ling Cottage had been on the market for a shade under £400,000, and Miss Lane, retired in her 30s, had paid cash. It all added to the mystery, of course. A car drew up somewhere in the road she could not see, while she was telling herself off for being so ungrateful. She had a home that would be the envy of millions. It might be Robert, so she walked back down the lawn and in through the patio doors. He was already inside, hanging up his jacket in the hallway, something his father always did, and then taking an envelope out of one of the pockets. "Happy birthday, Mum. I'm sorry about tomorrow, but when you come over for tea, we'll have a proper do. Marie's already baking away." He gave her the card and watched while she opened it. Many happy returns, lots of love from the both of them. It would be nice to see a little squiggle or two at the end, but Marie, who was French, was yet another one of these career girls, presently in charge of marketing Cornwall to tourists around the world. Judging by the queues of traffic coming into the town every day, she was doing a wonderful job. No chance of a grandchild in this country for a few more years, by the look of it. Robert walked through to the lounge to turn on the television, apologising as he went, but the court case was due to begin on Monday, and there was talk at the station that it might make the local television news. If they got the result they deserved, he said, it would make the nationals as well. It could be the highest-profile people smuggling case ever. The coffee machine began to hiss and bubble, but she could hear Robert's voice saying something like, "So, Mum, how are you doing? Everything okay?" as he fiddled with the tuning. The signals in Cornish Coves are as famously temperamental as the weather. Emily called back, "Yes, dear, I'm fine. Just bored to death as usual." She heard a vague, "That's good then," followed by a burst of television noise. "So I thought I might take up paragliding. You know, buy one on eBay and just jump off the cliff one morning."
"Good idea, Mum."
He was still tuning it in and taking not the slightest notice of her. Promotion to detective sergeant had come very quickly, and now he obviously had an important role in this case. Her irritation at being ignored fought a brief battle with her pride in his ambition and success, and lost. Robert Willows appeared in the doorway with a puzzled frown and said,
"What did you just say, Mum?"
"Never mind, my love. Here, take your coffee through, and there's a plate of homemade biscuits as well. Eat some. I don't suppose you'll get a proper lunch."
There was nothing on the news, but he told her a little about the case. No details, obviously, but this was a potentially significant investigation. Private airfields and isolated coves had been used to smuggle people into the country over the past 2 years. Nothing new there, Robert Willows said. It's a near epidemic. But this particular lot were offering something different. Business-class illegal entry to small numbers of wealthy, influential people and their families, with all the necessary paperwork provided as a part of an individually tailored service. "And that's where it gets interesting," he said. "Some of the documentation being provided is genuine. Somewhere along the line, these people have connections into the higher echelons of government bureaucracy." Emily Willows had looked suitably impressed and concerned.
"Well, that's serious, isn't it? It could get political."
Robert seemed to relish the idea.
"Oh yes, it will. Detective Superintendent Harley has made that clear from the beginning. But if anyone can pull it off, he can. He's an organisational genius. Earlier this week, he..."
And as he told her more about the case, she thought that he probably should not, but it was nice that he wanted to, because so often as a mother you become a sort of afterthought, an item near the bottom of a to-do list. They fly away, and it's not so bad if your partner is still there. It can even be liberating to have time together again, with money to spend on yourselves for a change. But then Ron had died suddenly, just at that moment when it was happening for them. He had died,
and now she really was bored enough sometimes to feel like jumping off a cliff. Robert stayed for almost an hour in the end, and he didn't do all of the talking. She told him about her neighbour, aware of how trivial her concern seemed compared to his. But he pretended an interest and said laughingly that if she had any real worries, he could always make a few inquiries about the mysterious Miss Lane. His guess, though, was that if she had come from London and had the money to buy Ling Cottage, and if she was indeed retired, then she was probably in the same business as Dad, something in banking or hedge funds or investments. The new generation of money superstars could make enough in bonuses in 5 years not to need to work for the rest of their lives. Wouldn't that be dull, though, Mum? Sitting around all day with plenty of dosh in the bank but nothing to do. They could drive you round the bend.
Yes, she said, as she got up to fetch him another cup of coffee. I expect it could.
Chapter 2. At 3 o'clock on the same afternoon, Emily Willows went out into the garden again. The sky was momentarily overcast now, and the air was very warm and humid. Ron would have complained about it, and said that though it was hotter in Greece, that was more pleasant, a drier sort of heat. He always said that, every year. She smiled at him and got on with the tasks that she had set herself, which was to deadhead all the roses he had planted in the 3 years they had spent here together. Coming to Polcombe had been the beginning of his winding down to a proper retirement after the pressures of corporate life. Not before time, she had said, because Ron was 7 years her senior. But as it turned out, the move had not been made in time enough. She pushed the wheelbarrow along to the next border. Her next-door neighbour was back. She hadn't seen her return, but she must have done so because there was some noise from the house, and then it became a little louder, as if the woman had opened her patio doors. There was the sound of music, music that Emily Willows recognised because she had heard her younger sister play it many times, the opening to Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto. Jane had almost taken the professional route after passing every examination going, and then one morning her sister announced that she was going to have a life instead. She married a dentist, had 4 children, and lived one of quiet contentment in Ruislip. Emily stood for a moment, secateurs in one gloved hand and fading roses in the other, and wondered why she was surprised by her neighbour's taste in music. Then she told herself off quite sharply this time, because it really was none of her business, and because she really didn't want to be thought of as the nosy old woman next door. At 4 o'clock precisely, as she did every day when she was at home, Emily Willows went back inside and switched on the kettle that had been filled ready after lunch. Leaf tea, 2 spoonfuls, into the Wittard ceramic teapot, and one of the bone china cups with matching saucer. Brew for 3 minutes, 3 or 4 stirs, and pour through the strainer. Put 3 rich tea biscuits on a tiny plate from the same tea service, and take a seat at the small walnut table by the patio doors, so that she could admire the garden and enjoy the slight breeze as the sun began to decline from its zenith and the shadows from the old stone wall began to inch across the lawn. I would never admit to being lonely, she told herself, but a little more company would be welcome. She could have called Margaret or Stephanie today, of course, and they would have come up to here, or she would have gone down into the town to see them. They could have had tea in the shop that overlooks the harbour, and cakes, and hours of nattering about the tourists. But she was already booked by them tomorrow morning because of her birthday, and if they met today, there would be less to talk about then. So, she reflected, I eke out my experiences. I make them last. I measure out my dull existence with teaspoons. And at 4:20 precisely, there was a knock on the front door. Emily stood up and went to answer it. Door-to-door salespeople were unusual in the town, but it might be a meter reader, it was due, or more likely charity fundraisers, who seemed to think that everyone who lived in Polcombe must be a millionaire with a guilty conscience. She straightened her back, found her stern look, and prepared to repel boarders. 2 men, one standing a little further away from the door. The man nearest to her wore a dark grey suit, somewhat inappropriate for the weather, but obviously some sort of business person. Though it wasn't a good suit, she had to say, and it didn't fit him particularly well. Neither, for some reason, did his skin. It seemed too tightly drawn across the face, making the nose beak-like, and it had an unhealthy pallor, a yellowness that made Emily Willows think that he might have problems with his liver.
For a moment, no one spoke, and she glanced at the second man, younger, taller, and much bigger, round-shouldered with huge hands hanging loosely by his sides, wearing a shiny bomber-style jacket and cheap light blue jeans, with white but dirty and heavily scuffed trainers. He seemed to be more interested in looking up and down the street than at the woman whose door his companion had just knocked upon. The besuited man said,
"Mrs. Willows?"
"Yes."
"I wonder if we might have a word?"
"Do you? Well, it rather depends on who we are and what it is that you would like a word about."
It's best to be brisk with doorsteppers, Ron used to say. Don't let them get the upper hand. She was already sure that these two characters had nothing to say in which she could possibly be interested. The yellow-faced man presented her with a smile of many teeth and much insincerity, but it was his next words that alarmed her, because she knew in that instant that he was lying, and that they might be dangerous.
"We're police officers, madam."
The lock on the door was a yell. If she had stepped back quickly and closed it, if she had even run out of the street so that the world could see and hear, if she had done anything but what she did, which was to confront them on her doorstep with the famously clichéd,
"Oh, really? I would like to see your warrant cards, please."
The same unhealthy grin, as the nearest man reached into his inside jacket pocket, while simultaneously half-turning towards his companion and saying,
"All clear."
"Yeah, get on with it, for Christ's sake."
"Certainly, Mrs. Willows. Here's my warrant."
He had taken out what appeared to be the bone handle of an old-fashioned knife. As she watched, he rolled it somehow in his fingers, and a blade appeared, a single-sided blade, a cutthroat razor. He stepped in close to her as she opened her mouth to call for help, or at the very least protest. But his other hand, the left, against her chest and pushed hard, sending her staggering backwards into the hallway. Within seconds, both men were inside, and the door was closed. No one could have seen, and no one would hear her scream, but she did so anyway, loudly and angrily as she backed away from the grey-suited man into the lounge. He sprang forward with surprising speed and caught her wrist, telling her to shut up. Now he had the blade in one hand and her wrist in the other, so she did the appropriate thing and brought up her knee. She was close, but not close enough. He swore, raised the blade, and then, very clearly, changed his mind. Instead, he let go of her wrist, bunched his other fist, and hit her hard in the face. She had never been struck in anger before, not in her entire life. Ronald had been the gentlest, most even-tempered of men, and as a child she had grown up in a safe, clean, and polite world where violence was viewed with disapproval and switched off at the wall if it intruded into their young lives. And as she stumbled backwards onto the sofa, with no pain yet, just a lightning strike of stars, she thought, "Men don't hit women. Men do not hit women. But he has hit me hard in the face, and I can already taste blood. I'm going to die. Or worse." The younger man had watched these events from the doorway of the lounge, as if viewing a mildly entertaining scuffle in the street. When it seemed to be over, he came further into the room, passed in front of her and drew the curtains across the patio doors. Then he went through into the dining room, and she heard him do the same thing. No one would be able to see in from outside, even if they did manage to get into the back garden. After that, she heard him moving about the house, no doubt making certain that nobody else was home. The hatchet-faced man, finally satisfied that her resistance was at an end, straightened up and waved his fist at her. He said,
"See that? That was me being nice. This," now slicing the blade through the air a couple of times, "is me being nasty. If neither of them works, you can have a chat with my friend through there. He don't say a lot. Don't need to. He can crush the bones in your withered old hand just by shaking it."
She looked down at her hands, spread either side of her on the sofa. They were not withered at all, and she still did pretty well on the pinch test. She knew what was going on. This was the psychological beating, designed to bruise her inside as well as out. She said nothing in reply.
"So, first of all, I need to get a couple of things straight, just to be clear. You're Mrs. Emily Willows, yes?"
She nodded.
"And Robert Willows is your son?"
Another nod,
But try as she might, she could not keep all the fear out of her eyes then. Robert, what had this to do with him?
We have to be certain. Don't want no mistakes. The second thing is this. If you do as you're told, you won't get hurt any more than you have been, and neither will your son.
Got that?
Do what I tell you, and this will be over in a couple of hours. Something to tell your grandchildren. Except you don't have any yet, do you? Let's hope Robert behaves himself as well. Otherwise, you might never hear the patter of tiny feet.
You getting all this? She nodded for a third time, looking him directly in the eye. Her mind was working surprisingly well, despite the pain in her cheek and nose, and it had already come to a number of conclusions. This was not a robbery, though she was beginning to wish that it was. She was to be some sort of hostage. Robert was involved in something awful and dangerous. These men had a plan because he had just said, over in a couple of hours, and they knew things about her family, which was almost the worst thing of all. How?
Good. We're getting somewhere.
Got a downstairs bathroom?
Through there.
Go in and wash the blood off your face. Clean yourself up. Don't want you looking a mess. Leave the door open. 60 seconds. Go on.
In the mirror, she could see that there would be a bruise on her cheek, and the right side of her nose was painfully sore. She eased it around gingerly, but there was no click or grating of bone. Probably not broken. She had bled onto her upper lip, so she took the chance to wash her whole face in cold water and gather her senses. Fighting them was out of the question, and she had little in the house she could use as a weapon. If she managed to stab one with a kitchen knife, the other would exact a terrible revenge. She might be able to escape. They had already let her out of their direct line of sight for a minute, but they would be watching the windows and doors. Call someone. The landline was on the tiny table in the hallway, and her mobile phone was in her handbag, on the work surface in the kitchen. If she could call Robert and warn him. Hatchet Face was in the bathroom doorway, watching her and scowling.
That's 2 minutes. You do exactly as you're told, remember? Back on the sofa.
He followed her through the hall, and she heard him rip the plug out of the landline socket. When she was seated again, he said,
Where's your mobile?
I cannot remember. I often lose it anyway. And with all this... Shout all you like. I'll only get more confused.
She could see him considering whether this was resistance worth dealing with, or simply the truth. After a moment, he said,
Do your best to remember. It might not be me asking you next time.
The round-shouldered giant of a man came into the lounge and was asked whether it was all clear. Apparently it was.
Okay, then. You watch her, and I'll make the call. Let's have the family snap first.
He took out a phone. The younger man stepped in behind her and put one of those huge, shovel-like hands on her shoulder, an act of violation that made her grit her teeth. She caught the faint odours of stale sweat and greasy food. The phone clicked, and its owner said,
There we are. All done.
So that was the proof that she was being held hostage, and the chances were that Robert would see the picture soon. She could only imagine how he would feel, and the imagining frightened her. What on earth was he involved in?
Let's hope Robert behaves himself, the man had said.
The sickly yellow face was watching her own closely, and he saw the fear. She knew then that this was his specialist subject, fear and its uses. He looked at the image on his phone and said,
You don't take a bad picture for an old dear. Anyway, I'm off to have a word with my people. You just sit there and make yourself comfortable, and then when I come back, you can make us a nice cup of tea. Milk and 2 sugars.
He made the two-fingered gesture that means eyes to the man behind her and left the room. The remaining man had let go of her shoulder and stood in silence. At that point, she was too afraid to turn around and look at him. The yellow man was thoroughly unpleasant and smug with his own knowledge of that fact, but the impassive, impersonal threat emanating from his partner was somehow more alarming. The call was made from just inside the front door, where he imagined that she would hear nothing. Not so. She heard distinctly at the beginning,
just a little slap, all quiet now.
And then some monosyllabic responses. Someone was questioning him about what he had done and said. Then she picked out,
Yeah, Jammy's in place, but we don't need him.
I told you...
Before he was silenced again by whoever was on the other end. Jammy, an odd name. Not Jamie, but sounding more like the word.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.